we're back in the test kitchen, inside no less, on this first day of summer. It is gorgeous out, and the fish have been biting. Now, I don't know how you've been catching all your fish, but I've been skunked all summer long. Since you have fish, you're going to teach us how to do a wonderful smoked salmon today. I can't wait. All right, well, I want to know how it's done.
Well, we were lucky enough to catch a few this weekend.
A few? So you caught like 8 million every day.
Yeah, well, you know, you just have to
getting like the daily
secrets.
Updates from
I've had a good teacher. One of the charter guys has been teaching me how to fish. So
I need to take that lesson.
Plus, my dad has taught me over the years. So, okay, today we're going to smoke salmon. It's it won't be like the traditional smoked salmon, because I think traditionally they smoke salmon to preserve the fish. Mm-hmm. So they probably dried it a lot harder, and they maybe use a lot more salt. So what we're going to do today is smoked salmon that's not going to have as much salt, and it won't be quite as dry. We're not going to leave it in the smoker as long as I left mine in last night because I went fishing. But so anyway, and everyone has their own way of smoking. And
exactly.
This is just the way I do it. Other people have their own ways, and you know, it's just a matter of preference. So the first thing we're going to do is make the brine that we're going to brine the salmon in.
And I see that you grabbed all of the cool ingredients from your very own Tatsuda's IGA.
Well, yeah, we have the IG salt and the brown sugar and the black pepper and the garlic powder and onion, minced onion, and Tabasco, and the Ketchikan soy sauce. The
only thing, this is something I've never seen, a Chardonnay. I can't wait to see that.
Well, yeah, you mix that half and half with the soy sauce, basically.
All right, okay.
And it just gives it a little bite, a little flavor on the fish. And this came from the liquor store because we can't sell it at that store.
Exactly. But how convenient. It's right next door.
Right.
So if I go shopping at your store, I can always get everything right there.
Right. So we're going to start with about a cup of brown sugar. So
now, you mentioned to me before we started that you do it a lot like I do when you're cooking. You just kind of eye it. So for the show's sake today, we're going to say exactly, you know, a cup, and we're going to give pretty much some decent measurements for folks in case they've never done this before.
This is about a cup, maybe a cup and
more
a half.
Or less. There you go.
Now, whatever you stuff in there, that'll work. Okay, so brown sugar. Okay, and then we're going to put some salt in here. We do need a little bit, although the soy sauce does have salt. So a lot of people will go half and half on sugar and salt. That's a little bit too salty for me. And we're going to refrigerate the fish afterwards anyway, so we don't need that much salt. So we're going to put a couple ounces of salt in there, probably. Just enough so, you know, it got a little bit of a salty flavor.
Okay.
And black pepper. This is just a few spices. We're just going to shake a little bit in there, probably a teaspoon or so.
Now, why do you refrigerate it after? Because I've always, the way that I have been taught, the one time I've been taught, when you brine the fish, you're going to put it in the bucket, put something heavy on top of it, and you can leave it anywhere you want.
Well, you can, but I would recommend you put it in the refrigerator and keep it cold, because you're going to have to remember, this is fish.
Right.
And fish is perishable. So I would maintain the quality of the fish always cold. Like when you go out on your boat, put ice and seawater together. Make a slush ice kind of thing in a cooler.
Really?
Put the fish in there, keep it cold after you've caught it.
Interesting.
Because, you know, if you can keep them cold, then they don't spoil as fast.
Exactly. And who wants to eat spoiled
food
anyway?
Yeah, and I've kept these fish here in the cooler. The one advantage of having a grocery store is that you have these big walk-in coolers. So when you get in at 11 p.m. and you're tired and you don't want to have to fillet fish all night, you just put them on these little nice trays and put some film wrap over it and roll it in the cooler and worry about it later.
Nice bonus being the owner, right? Because no viewer can call up and be like, hey, can I have the keys to Tatsuda's after hours?
So a little bit of garlic powder. I'm just sort of shaking a little bit in. What we're trying to do is just give this brine a little bit of flavor.
Quick question for you. You know, this is your way of doing it. I wonder what are some of the other ingredients. Like, I've never seen the wine before, but what are some of the other ingredients that you might be able to throw into the mix to give it kind of a different flavor?
Friends of mine use different things. In fact, after they've brined it, before they put it in the smoker, they'll put some honey on it, or they'll crack pepper. One of my friends uses basil leaves, I believe.
Oh, that would be interesting. Now, I've got a friend that uses apricot glaze.
And they also said the recipe book that comes with the Little Chief Smoker says use sake.
Oh,
that's
really?
Where I got the idea of Chardonnay. But for years and years, I just used water. I went half and half soy sauce and water, and that worked just fine.
Okay, so Tabasco next.
Yeah, just a few shakes of Tabasco. Gives the fish a little bite. So, you know.
Now, after you smoke this, are you going to can it? Or I think there's like a million different ways that you can can it.
Right. If I was going to can it, I would still marinate it the same way.
Mm-hmm.
But, or brine it the same way.
Mm-hmm.
But I would not leave it in the smoker as long. In other words, I would put it in the smoker like we're going to do, and then maybe 1 hour's worth of smoke chips. And then the fish will still be basically raw.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would stuff them in the jars, and then I'd pressure cook the jars for like 2 hours at like
really?
10 pounds.
Interesting.
And that cooks the fish in the jar, and you still get that smoke flavor and the brine flavor.
Huh. Very interesting. Okay, so Tabasco, what's next?
Okay, so we got all the spices. Now we're going to use the Ketchikan soy sauce. And these are nice, handy 20-ounce bottles. So just dump the whole thing in there.
Oh, really? Okay.
You know,
you know what I think is really cool? And I didn't know this. You were telling me I stopped in to grab something at the store. I got some awesome barbecue meat for this huge party that we had recently. And that was amazing. But right behind me, as I'm right there talking to Joe in the meat section, right behind me, you were there. And I totally didn't know that Tatsuda's has this amazing array of all of this sushi stuff. I mean, it's top notch. I took a gander around because I'm a big sushi fan.
Mm.
There's a lot of stuff in there.
Yeah, we have a relatively small area with Oriental food.
Mm-hmm.
But, and most of it, it started out mostly Japanese because my grandparents were from Japan. So over the years, we've refined the selection down to just the fastest selling stuff. And yeah, we do have the seaweed for the sushi, the flat rolls, or we have the small rolls. We have the tofu, fried tofu bags that you can stuff sushi rice into.
Oh.
We have seasonings, although the basic seasoning for sushi rice is just rice vinegar. You just take a rice vinegar and shake it on the cooked rice and mix it all up, and that gives it the sushi flavor.
Well, I was very impressed, very impressed.
And we have the rollers you can roll sushi in.
Well, I'm coming in next. That'll be the next show. There you go. Okay, so how much more?
And I tell you, there's a guy in town who taught me how to make sushi. He's a contractor, John Matsura. But he doesn't want to come on your show, so.
Oh, no, you've already asked him?
Yeah, he didn't answer his phone for like a week. He thought you might call him. So, anyway.
Some people are shy.
So we need about 20 ounces of this. This is a liter and a half. I'm just going to guess, okay? About a third of this, I guess. I don't know. What's 20 ounces? I'm not that. I used to be good at math, but now that I'm older.
So now this amount that we're making, and it's about up to there now, probably go up about halfway. How many pounds of fish will this work for?
You can put almost an indefinite amount of fish because the level just keeps rising.
Oh, okay.
You know.
Interesting.
But yeah, this batch is much larger than we need for the amount of fish we have. Okay, next we have to stir all this. So hand me that spoon.
And there you go.
We'll just stir away. What you have to do is make sure all the sugar dissolves. That's the main, in the salt.
It smells really good.
So you just start stirring away. Actually, a friend of mine who's been fishing, coming up every year fishing with me for 32 years now, he makes a brine, but he said, well, I just buy the big bottle of Yoshida's and you don't have to do all this mixing.
There you go.
And it works just fine for him, so.
But there's a million and one different recipes out there. I mean,
Yeah, a friend of mine told me last year, he just takes half brown sugar and half salt.
And that's it.
And mixes it all up and then dumps the fish in there and mixes it all up and, you know, and it works for him. But,
All right. You
know, obviously didn't work for me. So
I like this. Now, where did you find this recipe at? Is this just
to be honest with you, the little chief smoker has a booklet. And pretty much all this stuff was in there except the Chardonnay, and they recommended sake.
Really?
Yeah, but basically that recipe. So I, you know, when I bought the smoker, you know, 30-some years ago, I read the book, and I tried, okay, I'll do what they say, it turned out pretty good. So
now, I've got to ask, I mean, you have been hauling in the fish this past weekend. You've been out for 3 days in a row.
Four nights. Just the nights.
And almost limited out.
No, because you can get six fish each, so I haven't limited out.
But a lot of fish.
Yeah, we got 17 kings.
Holy cow.
And we lost a whole bunch.
And how much during a season do you put away?
Well, most of the fish I catch goes to the people I take out with me. So personally, not that much, actually. And we eat a lot of it fresh. And we have at the store, I'm lucky again, I have a vacuum pack machine. And
perfect.
Yeah, so, okay, that's
it. So our brine is ready.
Next up is to cut the fish up into smoking-sized pieces. So we'll have to clear this and
get busy. So I have a question for you. Special knife that you recommend?
Well, I like these. I get them at Tongass. They're serrated, and you can cut through the bone and the skin. The toughest thing about the fish is cutting through the skin and the backbone. Yeah. And this will do both.
Very nice.
That's why, and I have a friend who knows how to sharpen them. I don't. Okay, are we ready?
Ready, let's go. Okay. Show me how to do this.
Okay, so here is a fillet of king salmon. And it was, you know, not too dark. We got it out at Herring Cove. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to cut it in the smoking size pieces. Now, one thing you want to notice here, you see all this marbling here?
Yeah.
This is like belly meat. Belly meat is the best part of the fish and the best part for smoking because it's got a lot more fat in it. And you can see these layers of fish. When you cook them or you smoke them, you can just peel off one layer at a time and eat them.
Oh, cool.
So this is the primo part. And so when I'm smoking or taking my share, guess what share goes to my house? So it's the bellies. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to whack the belly off. So we're going to just kind of follow the belly line there. Hopefully it went
through. I feel like I should stand back.
Yeah, you should, because, you know, we don't want to have to do EMT stuff on the show. So, okay, and I screwed that
up
a little bit.
So how long has Tatsuda's been in business? Because there's a pretty cool story, I think, of your family.
1916 is our best guess. My grandfather came here the first time in 1910. And he was here a few years, and the first time he came, he was working for the canneries. And the canneries would come, and they only can a couple months a year. And then they'd load all the canned salmon, and all the crew, and back on the ship, and they'd all leave. And then they'd come back the next year. Well, one year he decided to stay in Ketchikan over the winter. So then he had odd jobs and stuff like that. I don't know what he did. He probably swept floors and that kind of stuff. Eventually, he did some hand trolling. Back then, hand trolling was you had a rowboat and you rowed the boat. That was hand trolling.
Oh, no.
And they didn't have fishing rods or downriggers or hand girdies. They had like a branch with a twine tied to it with the hook. So, and he was out at Bond Bay. There's a nice beach out at Bond Bay, out by Camino. And so they would camp out on the beach, and they'd go out and row their boats and catch fish. And then once a day, a tender would come and buy the fish. And it was like 50 cents a fish. No matter how big it was 50 cents a fish. And they wouldn't buy White King, because White King,
really?
No one would believe that it was salmon, because it was white. Salmon has to be this color.
Interesting.
Oh, even in this into the 60s, white salmon, you did not get a decent price for white salmon. You were better off taking it home and eating it.
So, fascinating.
Yeah, now it's considered
so coveted.
Delicacy, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so we can just dump this into the brine.
Just dump it right in?
Yeah, as I'm cutting it here.
Okay. It smells so good over here.
Yeah, and you notice, basically, the sizes I'm doing, they have to be wide enough so they don't fall through the rack.
Exactly, that makes sense.
And they have to be small enough so that they will dry. Otherwise, if you have a big hunk, it'll take you too long to get all the way through and dry it. So you want them about this size.
Okay. So then he was here, and so how did the grocery store happen, though?
Another nice story. My So, you know, being a single man and stuff, he said, well, maybe I should get a wife. So he sent back home to Japan and said, I'd like to have a wife. And so the families in Japan got together and decided who to send. And back in those days, you know, our country was more racist, you know.
Unfortunately.
So single Asian women were not allowed to come to the country. They had to be married. So the families got together and they did a proxy marriage, you know, with the stand-in as the groom.
Holy cow, that's so interesting.
So this, she was formally married, had a certificate, and so they met each other at the dock in Seattle, and they each had a picture of what the other looked like, the traditional picture bride. So that's how she got here. She was 17 years old.
Wow.
And you know, he was a little older, not that much older. And they had 9 children. Unfortunately, back then, children died early.
Yeah.
So 5 of them survived through adulthood. So, you know, that's the story of how... And so when the wife got here, she's at home all the time. Well, let's start a little store. So they put a little store in. It was on Stedman Street, about halfway up that hill as you're going towards our store from the Salvation Army. There's a hill.
On the left or the right?
It was on the left side going halfway up the hill. There's a little empty lot there now, parking lot, and that's where our store was. And there used to be a stairway. It was called Tatsuda Way, but it's no longer there, and they took the sign down. So.
Aw.
So, anyway, there's no more Tatsuda Way. Let's see, those are probably...
This fish looks really nice.
Okay, put those in there.
What, in all of the years that you've been in the grocery business, what's the most interesting thing about it to you? What's your favorite thing about being our local grocer?
That's a good question.
I mean, because you're always out there. You're so accessible on the floor. I always see you.
You know, I guess it's a real people business. You come into contact with everybody because everybody has to eat. So you are exposed to a wide range, the complete range almost, except maybe people who are institutionalized. There's some of them too that aren't incarcerated yet.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yet.
So I think that's the most interesting thing. And growing up as a kid, I had to work in the store, and you know, I had a...
That was going
to
be my next question. What was your first job in the store?
My grandfather, well, he wanted me to trim lettuce when I was about 4. But back then, they didn't have refrigerated containers. The lettuce came in slimy, so here's my grandfather. He gets a stool and stands me over a big garbage can. And he says, okay, trim the lettuce. Here, show. He's starting to show me, and I'm starting to cry because I don't want to touch this stuff. So that was supposed to be my first job, but I didn't do it. I refused. You know. So then he gave up for a while. And then he came up with another idea. One day, I think I was about 6 then. He waited a couple years. And he came in. I came into the store, and normally when I was there, I was just playing. But he said, okay, we're going to face the cans on the shelf. We're going to bring them forward. So he had me do the bottom row because he was getting old and he couldn't get down on the floor. So I got to do the bottom row of shelves. And then I would do like a section and then I'd go show him what I did. And then he'd ooh and ah and tell me how great a job I did. And then he'd give me a dime and a Coke, a little small bottle of Coke. Well, I got hooked on the Coke, and so I would just go down there and do the job for the Coke. And then I'd save all the dimes. So that was my first job, facing shelves at Tatsuda's. It was called Jimmy's Grocery for a long time. And then they remodeled the store. And actually, we had a fire in 1947 before I was born, and they actually moved down to right next to Diaz Cafe.
Oh, okay.
Across from the Salvation Army. So that's where I grew up working, actually.
What is, in your mind, what is, because I'm always in Tatsuda's, and I think, to me, as your customer, One of the coolest things is Joe the Butcher. You can go in and get all these really cool things, special ordered. You've got the sushi stuff, which fascinates me, of course. And you've got a lot of other really, really cool things in the store. But if you were to say this is the one most interesting thing that we carry or that we offer our customers, what would it be?
Well, probably the strongest department is Joe. You know, Joe is probably the jewel of Tatsuda's, actually, because he can do anything for you.
Do you leave this on? Pardon me for interrupting.
Yeah. Well, it makes a nice handle when you're chewing on it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I really like the fact that we visited with him a couple of holidays ago, and he was spot on about the recommendations that he made, because what I was asking for was, if I don't want to serve your typical turkey or your ham, what would you recommend? And he explained to me that this is what I would do, and this is how you can order it, and how regularly and annually people will call him up weeks in advance of the holiday and say, I want this cut, and I want it cut like this, or what do you recommend, Joe? And bam, it's ready and waiting when they get to the store. So I like that.
You know, and he does a lot of work for some of the restaurants, you know. And he knows, actually, restaurants have a lot of turnover a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And he knows what they need more than they do half the time. I mean, he's already anticipating what they're going to need and when.
And the only other thing, well, not the only thing, there's millions of fascinating things to me about Tatsuda's, but the one other thing that I thought was very interesting was the fact that when we had Brita on the show, she talked about if you bring your plastic bags, your plastic grocery bags back in, you can be entered into a weekly drawing. So I thought that was pretty cool. You guys are, you know, those bags can be a major pain and they're a big litter problem.
Yeah, and we encourage recycling. In fact, we recycle plastic. All those bags, if you bring them back to the store, we send them back and they recycle it.
Now, the way that I've seen it is you put something heavy down and kind of press it down. Do you have to do that?
Well, it probably helps keep everything under the brine level. Or you can just go in there and stir it once in a while.
And how often am I going to leave this?
Okay, what my recommendation is that you put it under refrigeration, like make a big hole in your refrigerator, stick it in there. And with fish like this thick, you'd probably want to go at least overnight minimum.
I would think so, yeah.
And my wife discovered that if you leave it in there like 5 days, it works really well too.
Really? Yeah. Oh, that's interesting.
There's a little different texture, but it still tastes really good.
Awesome.
So you know, I would say at least overnight and longer if you don't have time to get it out and
You know
smoke
what thought it. Keeps crossing my mind is, what is some of the most interesting thing that you could put in your brine? And I hesitate because salmon is so good. I hesitate to even try it because God forbid that you should have a problem and ruin the fish. But what if you threw something in there, like, say, instead of the ground pepper, like whole peppercorns? Or what if you threw something like, I'm just going to make this up, like jalapenos in there or something along those lines? I wonder what that would taste like.
You could try anything, you know. It's probably like pizza. You can just experiment. You might hit on the next thing.
Who knows?
Yeah, because I know commercially, like when Silver Lining was doing smoked salmon, they would, after it was smoked, they would put like dill on it, or
oh, that would be good.
Cracked pepper, or there's honey. A friend of mine uses honey and basil leaves and cracked pepper. And, yeah.
That would be awesome.
There's a lot of different things you can do. But I think today I was just showing you real basic stuff.
Right.
You know, so this is.
And maybe if someone just moved to the community, or maybe they're just bored with their own particular recipe that they have right now, they could go ahead and use this, try something new, and then play around with it a little bit if they want it. To me, the most interesting thing is the Chardonnay in there. Mm. I'm going to try that with the next thing that we do. If we can catch a fish.
Yikes. My point of view on doing this show was just for someone who had never smoked salmon before, didn't have a clue. Now they kind of see what the basics are.
Well, and it's interesting that here we are in the official kind of beginning of summer, because Lord knows we have had some awful weather this summer, and today is like the hottest, sunniest day on record. In summer, though, think about the people that are transitioning through our community. This is your big turn time for the Coast Guard folks to be coming.
Oh,
and a lot of times those people are brand new to Alaska, brand new to Ketchikan, not familiar with this at all. And then you also have some of the seasonal folks that are in town, and maybe it's their first year here in Ketchikan. So this might be very, very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and another, I suppose, a possibility would be show how to can them, but it's relatively easy. What you do if you want to can this is after you take it out of the brine, you put it in your smoker for like 1 hour with smoke chips. Okay, just 1 hour. And then you take them out partially raw, stuff them in the pint wide mouth jars, and then you pressure cook them for 2 hours under 10 pounds of pressure.
Now, what do you put in the canning jar? Because I've seen it with oil, just the fish. Okay.
Yeah, now you could, if you want, you could put some oil in there or whatever. You could put flavoring in there too. But you can just put the fish and it'll be just fine.
Well said. So pop the lid on and in the fridge it goes.
So now what we're doing, we're taking the fish that's been brining and we're going to rinse off all the brine. And she's going to take them over and put them on the other trays and dry them with paper towels. So the idea is to start the drying process.
How long does it have to dry for?
You want to leave them out at room temperature for, maybe an hour.
Okay.
Maybe longer. What you want to do is get the internal temperature of the fish as close to room temperature as you can. That way, when you stick them in the smoker, you don't have cold in the center.
Right.
And warm on the outside. Then you won't get the right consistency on the fish. So we're doing basically two things. And we're rinsing all this stuff off, because if you don't, and you put it directly in the smoker, then you'll get all this film and paste all over the outside of your fish.
And a huge mess.
Yeah.
So I've got to ask, because you clearly have caught a good number of fish this year so far. Any hints? Because I'm definitely not getting it for one way, shape, or form.
Well, depends. Like, see, I'm what they call a real lazy fair weather fisherman. I don't like going out and dragging and dragging and dragging, trying to get a fish and not. So I only go out the best time of day, which is either crack of dawn or at dark, right before dark.
Despite the fact that there may not be a slack tide?
Doesn't matter on tide. On evening, there's an evening bite and a morning bite. Okay? The tide matters if you're not out in the late evening or the early morning. Then you start going, oh, okay. But it's not necessarily the slack tide. Every location has its own hot time, and it all depends on the tide and the location. Like if you have a point and the tide is going out, then you pick the side of the point that's protected from the current.
Huh, so, I didn't know that.
Yeah, so if you have a point, let's say the point sticks out like this and the tide's coming this way, then you fish in here. Because there's no current.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah. And you'll find that's where you'll usually find the feed. The feed is like herring, and the fish feed on the herring.
Now, where's your favorite place?
And so what happens is over time, you know, I started fishing when I was 6 years old on a regular basis with my dad. And he loved to fish, so we would go out maybe three nights a week and all day Sundays. I did that with him for 10 years, till I was 16.
Holy cow.
So I was 16, got a driver's license, and then it was all over for fishing with me. It was cruising. But over that period of time, we started out just going out and tying up the fish traps before statehood. Fish traps were every major point. And, you know, they caught all the fish and almost destroyed the salmon runs, but they were great places to tie your boat to, hang off of, and bottom fish off of them, because under the traps was a big shadow, and the herring would hang out in the big shadow, and the king salmon would hang out on the bottom under the big shadow. So then you would just tie up to the fish trap. Depending on which way the wind and tide was blowing, you just hang that side, and then you drop your line to the bottom, just like you were halibut fishing, only you'd be pulling king salmon all day.
And we'd, wow.
And we'd get 20 kings in a day. If we didn't get 20, then we would be long-faced, complaining when we got home. And a good day was 30. And back then, they didn't have limited entry on commercial. So all you had to do, it was just like buying a fishing license. You'd buy a commercial license for your boat, and you'd buy a commercial crew license for yourself, and you could sell the fish. So we would go out, and we'd come in at night or on Sunday, and the cannery watchman at New England Fish Company we'd ring the bell, and he'd get up out of bed and come down, open the cold storage up for us, weigh our fish, give us a fish ticket. We'd sell it. And I got
really?
And I got 10%. So off the top, I made more than my dad did, actually.
Wow.
But yeah, all good things come to an end, and statehood occurred, and they outlawed fish traps.
So
which was good for the fish. So we had to learn how to fish all over again. We had to learn how to troll, you know. Eventually, my dad got a hand troll permit, so we used those hand girdies. So we hand trolled for several years, probably 4 or 5 years, hand trolling. But, you know, I learned a lot about fishing during that time.
So in the absence of the big dark shadow underneath the fish trap, where is the big dark shadow now? Are you still bottom fishing?
Time of year, like right now, close to Ketchikan, you know, obviously the best spot to be fishing is like Herring Cove, because that's where the hatchery is.
Exactly.
And those fish come back to the hatchery. Okay, hatchery fish, I don't know, maybe it's because when they were growing up as little fry, the people at the hatchery came out and fed them every 4 hours, because every 4 hours there's a bite out there. So it's either early morning, late night, or sometime there might be one or two during the day. But in between, you'll have 4 hours of nothing.
Maybe I'm fishing in the 4 hours of nothing lately.
Well, a lot of people
like it.
A lot of people do. So I always go out there. I'm a late person, so I go out and I don't go out too early, because then you quit too early. So then I fish till, you know, the bite might start at 7, might start at 8. Might start at 9. You just wait.
Patience is a virtue.
Yeah. The other thing that we discovered, these hatchery fish at Herring Cove, the first year they came back was 1985. And the aquaculture guy happened to tell me one day at Rotary Club, because I was president of Rotary that year, actually. Well, he told me, he says, the commercial guys were all out there. They had a 9-day or 10-day opening, and they fished, waiting for those fish to return. They fished 9 days, no one caught a fish. On the 10th day, everyone quit except one troller, and he got 100 kings.
Oh, really?
So they all came in at once. So I went, oh. So I went down there. You know, my boat was at Clover, at Knudsen Cove. So I went down there that weekend, got down there 7 at night, and we got 5 kings, just like that. You know, it was easy. So I left my boat a hole in the wall. I tied it at the end of the dock crosswise. Went out there the next morning, we got 6 more. And back then, the limit was 2 per person. And so since 1985, we've just been nailing them out. It's, you know, and we're spoiled. So if those fish ever stop coming, then I'm going to have to learn how to fish all over again.
There you go. So Herring Cove it is. We are needing to dry our fish next,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so let's,
look
without
that.
Dripping
tray's
all
amazing.
Over your floor, let's maybe do one tray at a time. If you see people catching fish, ask them, how deep are you fishing?
I agree.
You know, and if they like you, they'll tell you the truth. You know? Then when they get, and then as they dry, we can put some oil on those racks, and you can...
Is there any particular oil that you use? I mean, some people use cooking spray, just regular vegetable oil.
I brought a basting brush. My wife just uses paper towel and, you know, soaks it in vegetable oil and then rubs the racks. You know, whatever works for you. The whole idea
in my mind, whatever lessens the cleanup.
Yeah.
That's the key.
Yeah, because cleanup.
So just kind of.
And what you do is, to help the cleanup, what you would do is soak the racks for a while.
Soak them in what?
In water. Okay, you could take that one away.
So we're done? We can just do a little more blotting with the new ones.
Yeah, they keep blotting away. But you can see where the brine has soaked in because they're now a different color.
And I could feel it when I was moving them that some have a different kind of feel to them.
Yeah.
It's almost like when you marinate a steak, if you've ever done it accidentally too long, there's a certain feel to the meat.
Oh, yeah. Get a little.
But not to say that these are marinated too long. It just struck me that these particular pieces have gotten a lot more of the brine. And these were the ones that were on the bottom of the bucket too. So the timing's really important. So
when you brine your fish, you figure, okay, that's one day. You just brine it, stick it away in the refrigerator. Next day, you come out and you think, aha, I'm going to put this stuff in the smoker. But I have to start doing this, the drying and all that, like an hour before I put it in the smoker. Mm-hmm. And then once it's in the smoker, I'm going to have to be awake and change the chips at least once after an hour, maybe more, depends on how much smoke you like. And then I have to wait 8 or 12 hours.
Exactly.
Okay, so with me, I'll start maybe 4 or 5 o'clock in the evening, maybe even later, and shove it in the smoker and then go to bed.
Yeah.
And then wake up in the morning.
I'm done with that. I agree.
It's about ready. So it's taking a lot of time to do this, but you're not waiting for anything.
Exactly. Make it low maintenance.
Yeah. Yeah. And once you get a rhythm going, then you can actually produce a lot of product with very little time involved.
Perfect. So you just use regular vegetable oil and a basting brush.
Yeah. And I suppose that if you had Pam or something, I don't know her last name, but you spray it all over. Okay. But this works for me. That's why I brought the newspaper, because it splatters all over everything. So you just want to go like this. I hope I'm not going to mess your racks up or anything.
Oh, no.
I don't know how you got them so clean if you've already smoked fish on them.
Actually, just yesterday.
Yeah. How did you get them so clean? My goodness.
I have a secret weapon. His name is Jeremy.
Oh, well, I know, but he got in between the things. Okay, you can take that one off. Holy smokes,
he also does ovens very well too.
Oh, does he have a special cleaner or something? Or?
I don't know. I think he's got a lot of elbow grease.
Oh, well, that's one thing I don't have. I'm not known for my scrubbing abilities. Or any ability.
This feels, now we used Pam yesterday, mm-hmm. and actually it took a little bit of elbow grease to get these racks cleaned. I'm feeling a little more comfortable with the basted on vegetable oil. So yeah. I'm real anxious to see how that works.
And I don't know if one's any better than the other, to be honest with you. Okay, well we used all the oil in this.
So I have a question for you. I already know the answer, but I want to ask it. It was just generally assumed that you would be in the family grocery business, correct?
I was forced into the business.
Were you?
When I was in seventh grade, my dad says, okay, after school you come to work, which I did. And one day I didn't. I stayed home and practiced guitar. Wanted to be a rock star or something. And my dad says, well, you didn't come to work today. And I said, no, I was playing the guitar. And he says, well, you better come to work tomorrow, because if you don't, you're not going to get lunch money for school.
Oh, no. There you go.
So I went to work. So basically forced into the family business. But, I can't complain.
Well, now you and your wife, Catherine, works at Tatsuda's. Your daughter, Catherine, works at Tatsuda's.
Didn't I forced her?
Did you really?
Well, it took me a little longer. I wasn't as, I didn't understand that you got to start your kids off early and give them that work ethic. I, you know, I pampered them too much when they were growing up, and so, you know, it took me a while.
To get them involved?
To get her involved. But
there you go.
But now that's, yeah, she's going to take over the store. That's the plan.
Very cool.
She's already...
So, Catherine, if you're watching, big plans on the horizon just for you.
She's already part owner, and she's doing a big chunk of the management and all my paperwork. So all I need, all I have to do when I go to work is stock shelves.
And visit with people, because I see you visiting with more people.
Yeah, and I just hired a guy who's really good, and he's going to be doing a lot of the stocking of the shelves. And probably, I'm hoping he'll end up managing the store at some point. So Catherine will have a, you know, someone down on the floor running, doing the hard, heavy.
So is this the little glimpse, that little tiny light at the end of the tunnel called retirement for Bill Tatsuda?
Well, actually, Bill Tatsuda will have to be tricked into going to dinner at the Pioneer home and then not being able to leave because I like what I do, and it's also part of my retirement plan. You know, I keep getting paid.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. So I'm actually tricked Catherine a little bit here.
Perfect. Okay, so we've oiled our racks and we have dried off the fish.
Right.
Now we, at this point, would fire up the smoker?
Yeah, you would turn the smoker on, get it preheated, and...
And at what temperature?
Do you have a choice?
Good question.
Smoker doesn't have a choice. I just plug mine in.
Exactly. Plug it in, and what my question is, though, is there a mistake in terms of temperature? Could you feasibly make it too hot? Could you feasibly ruin it?
Yeah.
Or is it just that easy? Plug it in and slide the trays
well,
in.
Well, if you have a temperature control, I would think you would want it probably set about 165, just because that's the recommended temperature when you cook fish and poultry. I think they want it internally that high.
I hope so. Don't look at me. I don't know.
But if you don't have a choice, just plug it in and stick the fish in there.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Now, my other question is, and we've got these racks kind of laid out. I'll move this to the side. I'm going to take approximately how many, and we're going to do that outside, but is there a trick? Can they not touch
We could load one, but the other thing is the thick ones you want to put on the bottom of your smoker because it's closer to the heat.
Oh, okay. Right? Now, I didn't know that.
Okay, so thick ones closer to the bottom, and then like the bellies, the thinner ones, you want a little higher on your rack.
Yeah, like
so,
these.
Yeah, so that way the bottom ones get the most heat. So that would go, yeah, that would go over there.
On the top.
Yeah.
But insofar as what I was asking.
And then
asking,
you want a little space in between, but you can load them up, you know, that.
Like about that?
Yeah, because if you have a lot of fish, you want to get as much as possible into the smoker.
Exactly, because it could be a long process.
Fortunately, we don't have that much right here, so it won't be a big challenge.
So kind of like putting together a mini puzzle, if you will.
Yeah.
And that would be enough?
Mm-hmm.
Space?
Right. Just as long as you get airflow in between them.
Have you ever had anything go wrong in a smoker?
Well, yeah, it's a learning process, you know, and the little cheap smokers I had, you have to remember to empty the drip pan underneath or they fill up.
Right.
And then they start shorting out your heat element. So that I've had that happen.
Oh, jeez. Well, you know, smokers, if you get the good smoker, it is truly a good investment, I believe.
Right. The other thing you want to...
Is that too much? Is that good?
Yeah, that's probably fine.
Okay.
And then put all the thin ones on the next one. And then another thing you want to do is make sure your smoker is not sitting on your wooden deck.
I'm sure a chief share would like to hear you.
You want to, like with at home, I have a big wire rack that it's off the deck just so there's no contact because, you know, a smoker is a heat source.
Exactly.
And anything wood is combustible, fuel source. So you want to keep all those separate.
Well, and, you know, here's something else. This year, not so much, but I just remember this from being down south. So many people would sit the smoker in their yard, Or for that matter, a deep fryer. But they'll, oh, it's not on my wooden deck. I'm going to put it in my yard. Well, if it's been dry.
It's a forest fire.
Right. Yeah. You know, you've got to really watch about what's around that smoker. Yeah. Because just like you said, you don't want to start a fire.
Yeah. And I always keep a bucket of water, especially if I'm going to change the chips. Then you have a bucket of water that you can dump the chips, the ashes into. Because otherwise, you could start a fire with the ashes.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, think about what you were saying earlier. If you're going to do the overnight thing, safety is really paramount.
Right.
Because if you and your family are inside sleeping and this thing's going,
mm-hmm.
you know, so, you want it to be low maintenance, but you also want it to be safe.
Right. Now, another thing with a smoker like the one I have at home, you buy it and it comes in a cardboard box. I actually save the box. I leave the box over the smoker. Because it retains the heat inside.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And especially, like a day like today, it wouldn't matter that much. But a day like 2 or 3 days ago, when it was blowing and raining and 48 degrees,
yep.
you want as much heat in that smoker as you can get. So you want that cardboard insulation.
Yep, I agree.
So, you know, and then, you know, you want to keep it out of the rain if you can. So, we just have extra cardboard we stick on top of it.
My puzzle is, I'm trying to get it together well, but...
Might have to use another rack.
Yeah, I think we might.
Yeah, you will, so... And then you can take... So, well, anyway, maybe one trick is also, don't move them around too much once you've stuck it on a rack, otherwise you're moving the oil around too.
Oh, yeah. Yikes. Maybe Jeremy will have a big cleanup later.
Yeah.
So I will get this out of the way. And go with the, now here's, this would be a good middle rack because there's some thinner pieces left and some thicker pieces.
Right.
Is that a safe guess? Because look, some of these are much thicker. After it's smoked, do you do anything with it? So let's pretend this has been smoked and it came out of the smoker. Do you ever chop it up or make it into smaller pieces for canning purposes or?
Well, if I knew I was going to can ahead of time, I would have cut them into strips, the depth of the, lengthwise, the depth of the jar.
Right,
yeah.
So like that.
Yeah, so you can just shove them in lengthwise and they'll fit. And then you can put the lid on and everything will fit.
So if you're going to pull it out and eat it, and again, let's pretend that this is smoked, you're going to pull it out and eat it, what are some cool things that you eat it with on the plate?
I like being part Oriental, I guess, or whatever. I like rice.
There you go.
The Japanese is, you know, just fish and rice. That would be all I would need. Now, some people will make dips out of it.
There's dipping sauces.
Silver Lining used to hand out the famous Silver Lining smoked salmon dip, which was basically, I think, cream cheese and sour cream. But I don't know what else they did. Yeah. I just eat it straight, too, a lot of times.
Yeah, it's a good snack. It's a good and healthy one, too. Looks like we're ready to go. How about we go fire up the smoker?
Oh boy, that's a nice one. Yeah.
And it does have the temperature.
Yeah, I think to be safe, I think maybe at least 150.
We can always adjust it, but there's a lot of food safety kind of regulations that you all have to deal with at the store, so you probably know temperature better than
I do. Well, we've all had to take food safety courses, and what they tell you is 40 degrees to 140 is the unsafe temperature zone. So if you have food in that temperature for any length of time, you could create food poisoning hazard.
Wow.
So I would think if we're smoking fish and it's going to be sitting in here for 8 to 12 hours, we would want to be at least 150.
At least.
And they recommend, like, when you cook and stuff, internal temperatures on fish and things should be, I thought it was 160 or 165, so something to think about. Now, these, of course, fish have been brined, and they are in salt, and they've been brined, so that probably protects them to some degree.
I would imagine. So any trick to putting the wood chips in?
Well, yeah, where's the pan?
The pan is inside. I shall go grab it.
Oh, okay, yeah. And then we'll put these chips on there. My recommendation with the thickness of the fish we have, that you do at least two batches of chips. It'd probably be a couple hours with a smoke, and that'd probably be good. Unless you like a really strong smoke, then you could do another pan of chips. But actually, after the first hour or two, I don't think it absorbs any more of the flavor.
Now, those are apple chips in there.
That'll work.
But you've got alder chips. So yeah. What's the difference between the different chips?
Well, I guess the apple comes from an apple tree and the alder comes from an alder tree. But see, alder, you know how alders grow around here. This is probably the natural hardwood that the natives used. And that's probably why they use alder, mostly. That's the predominant one. But you can use any kind. I've seen, sometimes people use mesquite or what are the other flavors? Maple. There's lots of choices.
And always, we soak our chips in water first.
Oh, I don't think I would.
Really?
No, because you soak them in water if you're going to barbecue, like on charcoal and stuff.
That would be Southerners coming out in us, right?
Yeah, but what you want here is these things to start smoking.
Yep.
They're not going to, you want them to burn out fairly quickly.
Well, the ribs that we bought at Tatsuda's for the rotary party that we had recently?
Oh.
This is what we smoked them in, and they were fantastic.
I bet they were.
They were amazing.
Yeah. Well, what we're basically trying to do is just flavor the fish and dry them a little bit. So, I've never soaked my chips. So, I would say don't.
Okay.
If you want to do it my way. But you can
do it your way.
And then, okay, so we just load this up with the fish, and I guess you just turn it on.
Sounds good.
Come back in an hour and see if it's still smoking or not.
Looking good. So we've got the chunkier on the bottom. The middle has a combination of both. Bill just went back inside to get the thinner layers, which should always be on the top.
With this hot weather, you probably don't have to do it that long. Okay,
Good job. You just
shut it.
So 160?
Yeah, let's do at least that.
I'll go 165,
yeah,
go right down the middle.
I would. And then, I don't know.
Perfect.
Yeah, and then once you change the chips, set it, do at least 8 hours before you check it. And then look at them, and if they look too soft, then do them a couple more hours, and then just keep checking it.
It's kind of the grand experiment for a first timer, I would imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
But a fun one. You have fun catching it, and then smoking it, and hopefully you'll end up with a great piece of smoked salmon, a bunch of them too.
Right. Okay. Well, good luck. And you're going to let me know when it's done and we'll share it.
Excellent. Love it. So we get to try some now.
Yeah, we get to try some. And I have to apologize because I made these at home yesterday, so I'd have something to show today. And we left them in the smoker too long. I'm going to blame it on my wife because she wanted to go fishing last night. And so these were in there a lot longer than they should have been.
I bet they're really good though.
But I picked out the bellies, which have the most oil in them. And so these are probably the best that I could salvage out of that batch. Okay, notice we left the fin on this one because actually that's probably the best part of the fish right close to that fin.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
But we're going to try this. Now, these are all belly meat. You can kind of tell because you can see the texture.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me find a good one to put carbon on here. Feels like it's Thanksgiving, you know. Okay. If you get into this, you can kind of flake off the different layers. These are a little bit overdone, so you can't do it.
But, oh, wow, look at that.
But you can see it still has a bunch of oil in there. So, anyway, I would just say dig in, take a little taste. You grab a fork, and hopefully it won't gag you because it's so dry. It's a lot drier than I would have intended. A lot drier.
That was really good.
But it's a lot drier.
Mm-mm.
But the flavor is...
That's outstanding. Holy cow. All right, I now have my new recipe for smoked salmon because that is really, really good. And if this, you're saying if this is not your best, oh my goodness.
It's really dry for me. And also I've found that when you first take it out of the smoker and you taste it, it doesn't taste as good as it does after you've chilled it down. So if this was cold, it's kind of like drinking beer. I think they're a lot better cold.
Most folks do. There you go.
Yeah. So.
Excellent. Wow. Thank you so much. So, oh, wow. This is a great recipe. Thank you so much for being on the show. And hopefully you'll come back soon. Maybe we'll dream up something else that we can cook right out of Tatsuda's.
Yeah, maybe we can, or we could just tell stories.
Perfect.
All right, well, thanks.
Thanks for watching. Check us out next episode of Celebrity Chef.